Hello friends, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Ajay Solkhe, presently working as Assistant Professor, University School of Management, Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra, Haryana. In this module, we are going to deliberate upon three major acts. One is the Mines Act, another is Plantation Labor Act, and third is Beedi and Cigar Workers Act. Upon completion of the module, a student should be able to understand the major legal provisions contained in the Mines Act, Plantation Labor Act, Beedi and Cigar Workers Act, rules regarding the employment, leave, health, safety, penalties and offences in each of these acts. Very first of all, the Mines Act. The Mines Act 1952 came into force on 1st July 1952. It extends to the whole of India and prescribes safe and satisfactory conditions of work in the mines. For the purposes of the Act, the term mine refers to any excavation or operation for mining minerals. The Act applies to all types of mines, including mines of atomic minerals and oil fields. It was amended in 1983. Provisions regarding employment and leave. It contains seven set of provisions. One is hours of work, overtime work, employment of adolescent, employment of child, employment of woman, maintenance of a register and leave with wages. Regarding hours of work, the Act says that the hours of work of all adult workers, both surface and underground, should not exceed 48 hours a week. And further, that no worker will be required or allowed to work for more than 9 hours a day above ground with a time spread of 12 hours. When the worker is employed to work underground, his hours of work shall not exceed 8 hours a day, subject to the previous approval of the Chief Inspector of Mines. The daily maximum hours may be exceeded in order to facilitate the change of shift. Under the Act, no adult worker employed above ground is allowed to work continuously for more than 5 hours, unless he has been given a rest interval of at least half an hour. No person employed in the mine is allowed to work for more than 6 days in a week. If a worker is deprived of one or more weekly days of rest, as under the exemption provided in the Act, he has to be given an equal number of compensatory days of rest within 2 months, immediately following the month when the days of rest were due to him. No person shall be required or allowed to work in a mine if he has already been working in any other mine within the preceding 12 hours. The Act has fixed slightly longer hours of work for certain categories of underground workers, namely setters, pump winders or attendants, for the continuous operation of the machines. In their case, 54 hours a week has been prescribed and the daily hours of work and spread over has been fixed at 9. Overtime work. The Act says that except in an emergency involving serious risk to the safety of the mine or of the person employed therein, no person shall be allowed to work overtime, that is for more than 10 hours a day inclusive of overtime. Such persons as are employed above and below ground are entitled to be paid wages at double the normal rate. The period of overtime work is to be calculated on daily or weekly basis, whichever is more favorable to the worker. Employment of adolescent. No adolescent shall be employed in a mine below ground where the dust produced in mining operations is known to constitute a hazard to the health, or in close proximity to the machinery for crushing, screening, or preparing mineral or rock for use or sale, where the concentration of dust in the atmosphere constitutes a hazard to the health, in any operation connected with any machinery involving any risk or injury from any moving part, either of the machine or any adjacent machine, or in any work which is unduly arduous or alone in a place remote from the other working persons. No adolescent shall be allowed to work in any part of a mine which is below ground unless he has passed his 16th birthday, he has been having medical certificate in the prescribed form granted to him by a certifying surgeon, certifying that he is fit for work as an adult, is in the custody of the manager of the mine, he carries while at work a token giving a reference to such certificate, and he has half an hour interval of rest after every 4.5 hours of continuous work. The certificate of fitness granted or renewed shall be valid only for the period of 12 months from the date thereof, Certificate of fitness may specify the conditions of employment or the nature of the work in which the adolescent may be employed. The certificate can be revoked if it is found by the certifying surgeon that the adolescent is no longer fit for the work stated therein in a mine. No adolescent who has not been granted a medical certificate certifying that he is fit for work as an adult shall be employed above ground in a mine for more than 4.5 hours in a day and between 6 p.m. and 6 a.m. Section 40. Employment of a child. No child shall be employed in any mine nor shall any child be allowed to be present in any mine which is below ground or in an open cast working in which mining operations are carried on. The time of commencement and of the end of the work or release is to be notified outside the office of the mine through a notice passed on the notice board. Section 45. Employment of women. Employment of women underground in a mine is strictly prohibited. On surface, no woman will be allowed to work except between the hours of 6 a.m. and 7 p.m. Every woman employed in the mine above ground shall be allowed an interval of not less than 11 hours between the termination of employment of any one day and the commencement of the next period of employment. Maintenance of register. A register shall be maintained for every time in the prescribed form or place and shall show in writing the following information about the persons employed: the name of the employee and his father or her husband for the purpose of identification, the age and sex of the employee, the nature of employment, whether above ground or below ground, whether in open cast mining or otherwise, and the date of commencement of employment, such other particulars as may be prescribed. No person shall be employed in a mine until the above particulars have been recorded in the register, and further, no person shall be employed except during the period of work shown in respect of him in the register. Leave with wages. The Act says that the persons employed in a mine shall be entitled, in addition to weekly rest and festival holidays, to leave with wages after a calendar year's service at the rate of 1 day for every 16 days of work performed by them if employed below ground, and 1 day for every 20 days of work for work above ground. A calendar year service will, in case of a person engaged in underground work, means not less than 190 days attendance at the mine, and in case of others, 240 days of attendance. The various provisions regarding health and safety has been categorized into 7 head. The very first is drinking water, conservancy services, first aid, bathrooms, rest shelters, canteens, appointment of a welfare officer. Drinking water. The Act lays down that effective arrangements shall be made to provide and maintain at suitable points conveniently situated at least 2 liters cool and wholesome drinking water per worker. No such point shall be situated within 20 feet of any washing place, urinal, latrine, unless a shorter distance is approved in writing by the chief inspector. Such points should be clearly marked drinking water in the regional language. The supply of water per person per day has been fixed at 0.5 gallon. Such drinking water shall be readily available at conveniently accessible points during the whole of the working shift. Where 100 or more persons are employed either above ground or in open cast workings or at any one time, the inspector may, by an order in writing, require the drinking water to be effectively cooled by mechanical or other available means. Conservancy services. There shall be provided separately for males and females in every mine a sufficient number of latrines and urinals situated at a convenient place and accessible to persons employed in the mine at all times. The scale of latrine accommodation shall be at least 1 seat for every 50 workers on the surface and 1 seat for every 100 workers working below ground. Where persons of both sexes are employed, they shall be displayed outside each latrine a signboard in the regional language for males or for females, each signboard also showing the figure of a man or a woman, as the case may be. Where piped water supply is available, a sufficient number of taps conveniently accessible shall be provided in or near each latrine. Failing this, a sufficient quantity of water shall be kept stored in a suitable receptacles near each latrine. All latrines and urinals shall be adequately lighted, ventilated, and at all times maintained in a clean and sanitary condition. First aid. First aid boxes or cupboards in such numbers as may be prescribed shall be made available at suitable places on the surface, and first aid stations should be set up below ground. Every first aid box shall be kept in charge of a responsible person. There should be at least one trained person for every 100 workers working above ground and one for 50 workers working below ground. He should be readily available during the working hours of the mine. Every supervisor or an officer going below ground shall carry first aid equipment on his back. Where the number of persons employed is more than 150, provision should be made for a first aid room, which should be situated at a convenient place on the surface of the mine. An ambulance van should be maintained when the number of workers employing 500 or more. Suitable arrangements should be made for the convenience to hospitals or dispensaries of persons who, while employed in the mine, suffer bodily injury or become ill. Bathrooms. Under the Coal Mines Pit Head Bath Rules 1946, a pit head bath conforming to the specifications approved by the competent authority shall be constructed. Separate bathrooms should be provided for males and females, and the attendants should be on duty during all working hours. Adequate water supply, lighting and drainage arrangements should be provided in the bathroom. Rest shelters. At every mine employing 50 or more persons on any day of the previous calendar year, there shall be provided adequate and suitable shelters at or near loading wharfs, open cast workings, workshops and mine entrances wherein 25 or more persons are ordinarily employed at any one time for food and rest. Every shelter shall have a floor area of not less than 4 square meters, and in case there is a flat roof of a height of not less than 2.5 meters to the lowest part of the roof, and where the roof is a sloping one, the height of not less than 1.8 meters to the lowest part of the roof, and of not less than 2.5 meters to the highest part of the roof, shall be so constructed as to afford effective protection from the weather and be sufficiently lighted during all hours when open for use. Canteens. At every mine employing 250 or more persons on any one day in the previous calendar year, where the chief inspector so requires, they shall be provided within the precincts of the mine a canteen for the use of all persons employed. In every canteen, there shall be provided and maintained sufficient furniture, utensils and other equipment necessary for its efficient operation. An adequate supply of cool and wholesome drinking water, suitable clean clothes for persons cooking and serving food, drink, etc. The canteen and its precincts shall be kept in a hygienic condition. An adequate supply of hot water shall be provided for cleansing of utensils and equipments. Food, drink and other items served as a canteen shall be sold on a non-profit basis, and the prices charged shall be subject to the approval of the canteen managing committee. Appointment of a welfare officer. For every mine wherein 500 or more persons are employed, a suitably qualified welfare officer shall be appointed, and where the number of persons so employed in a mine exceeds 2500, such welfare officer shall be assisted by one suitably qualified additional welfare officer for every additional 2000 persons or part thereof. Penalties and offences. Contravention of provisions regarding employment of labour. Whosoever contravenes any provisions of the Act or Regulation, Rule or Bylaw, or any order made prohibiting, restricting or regulating employment or presence of persons in or about a mine shall be punishable with imprisonment up to 3 months or fine up to 1,000 rupees or both. The Plantation Labour Act. Here we are going to discuss some of the major legal provisions of the Plantation Labour Act 1951. With regard to the scope and coverage of the Act was passed on 15th October 1951 to provide for the welfare of labour and regulate the conditions of service in plantations. It extends to the whole of India except Jammu and Kashmir. The Act applies to any land used or intended to be used for growing tea, coffee, rubber, cinchona, which at measure 10.117 hectares or more, and on which 15 or more persons are employed or were employed on any day of the preceding 12 months or were employed on any day of the preceding to any of the above. The workers drawing rupees 750 per month are covered under the Act. The Act provides for compulsory registration of plantations. Chief Inspector and Inspectors. The State Government may, by notification in the Official Gazette, appoint for the State a duly qualified person to be the Chief Inspector of Plantations, and many duly qualified persons to be inspectors of the plantation subordinate to the Chief Inspectors as it thinks fit. The State Government or the Chief Inspector may declare the local area or areas within which, or the plantation with respect to which, inspectors shall exercise their powers under the Act, and he himself may exercise the powers of an inspector within such limits as may be assigned to him by the State Government. Certifying surgeons. The Act provides that the State Government may appoint qualified medical practitioners to be certifying surgeons for specified local limits or for each plantation or class of plantations. The certifying surgeon shall carry out such duties as may be prescribed in connection with the examination and certification of workers. The exercise of such medical supervision as may be prescribed where adolescents and children are or are to be employed in any work on any plantation which is likely to cause injury to their health under Section 7. Provisions regarding health. Drinking water. On every plantation, effective arrangements shall be made by the employer to provide and maintain at convenient places on the plantation a sufficient supply of wholesome drinking water for all the workers. Under Section 8, conservancy. They shall be provided separately for males and females in every plantation a sufficient number of latrines and urinals of prescribed types so situated as to be convenient and accessible to the workers employed therein. All such latrines and urinals shall be maintained in a clean and sanitary condition. Section 9. Medical facilities. On every plantation, there shall be provided and maintained such medical facilities for the workers and their families as may be prescribed. Where the Chief Inspector find that such facilities have not been provided or maintained, he may cause them to be provided and recover the cost from the employer. These costs may be recovered from the collector from the employer as areas of land revenue under Section 10. The provisions regarding welfare. The various provisions regarding welfare are canteens, crèches, recreational facilities, educational facilities, housing facilities, power to make rules relating to housing, other facilities, welfare officers. Canteens. The Act says that on every plantation wherein 150 workers are ordinarily employed, one or two canteens must be provided and maintained by the employer for the use of the workers. Without prejudice to the generality of the foregoing power, the rules may provide for the date by which the canteen shall be provided, the number of canteens that shall be provided, and the standards of their construction, accommodation, furniture and other equipment, the food which may be served therein, and the charges which may be made thereof, the constitution of a managing committee for the canteen, and the representation of the workers and the management of the canteen, the delegation to the Chief Inspector, subject to such provisions as may be prescribed, of the power to make rules under. Crèches. On every plantation wherein 50 or more women are employed or were employed on any day of the preceding 12 months, there shall be provided and maintained by the employer suitable rooms for the use of these women's children who are below the age of 6 years. Such rooms shall provide adequate accommodation, be adequately lighted and ventilated, be maintained in a clean and sanitary conditions, and be under the charge of a woman trained in the care of children and infants. The State Government may make rules prescribing the location and the standards of such room in respect of their construction and accommodation, then the equipment and amenities to be provided therein. Section 12. Recreational facilities. That says that the State Government may make rules requiring every employer to make provisions on his plantation for such recreational facilities for the workers and children employed therein as may be prescribed. Educational facilities. Where the children of the plantation workers in the age group between 6 and 12 exceed 25 in number, the State Government may make rules requiring every employer to provide educational facilities for the children in such manner and of such standard as may be prescribed. Section 15. housing facilities. It shall be the duty of every employer to provide and maintain for every worker and his family residing on the plantation the necessary housing accommodation, and also those residing outside and have put 6 months of continuous service. Power to make rules relating to housing. The state government may make rules for the purpose of giving effect to the provisions of Section 5. Other facility. The state government may make rules requiring that in every plantation, the employer shall provide the workers with the number and type of umbrella, blankets, raincoats, or other like amenities for their protection against rain or cold as may be prescribed. Welfare officers. On every plantation wherein 300 or more workers are ordinarily employed, the employer shall employ such number of welfare officers as may be prescribed. Hours and limitations of employment. There are certain clauses with respect to that. Weekly hours, weekly holidays, daily interval for rest, spread over, notice of period of work, prohibition of employment of young children, night work for women and children, non-adult workers to carry token. Weekly hours. An adult worker is required or allowed to work on any plantation for 54 hours a week and an adolescent or child for 48 hours a week. Weekly holidays. One day of rest is required in every week. If on any given day during the week, a worker is prevented from working by weather conditions, that day may be counted as his day of rest. A worker may work on his day of rest if he is willing, provided that it is not a closed holiday, but he must be paid at least the rate prevailing in the area, and he may not work for more than 10 days prevailing without a holiday under Section 20. Daily interval for rest. The period of work on each day must be so fixed that no period must exceed 5 hours and that no worker shall work for more than 5 hours before he has had an interval for rest of at least half an hour. Section 21. Spread over. The period of work of an adult worker on a plantation must be so arranged that inclusive of his interval for rest under Section 21, it shall not spread over more than 12 hours, including the time spent in waiting for work on any day. Notice of period of work. A notice of period of work for a worker shall be displayed and correctly maintained on every plantation. It will show clearly for every day the periods during which the workers may be required to work. No worker shall be required or allowed to work on any plantation otherwise than in accordance with the notice of period of work displayed on the plantation. An employer may refuse to employ a worker for any day if on that day he turns up for more than half an hour after the time fixed for the commencement of the day work. Prohibition of employment of young children. No child who has not completed his 12th year shall be required or allowed to work on any plantation. Night work for women and children. No woman or child worker shall be employed on any plantation between 6 p.m. and 1 a.m. But nothing in this section shall be deemed to apply to midwives and nurses employed as much on any plantation, Section 25. Non-adult workers to carry token. A child who has completed his 12th year of age and an adolescent may be allowed to work on any plantation if a certificate of fitness granted for that purpose is in the custody of the employer and such child or adolescent carries with him while he is at work a token giving a reference to such certificate. Certificate of fitness. A certifying surgeon shall, on the application of any young person or his parent or guardian, accompanied by a document signed by the employer or any other person on his behalf, that such person shall be employed on the plantation if certified to be fit for work, or on the application of the employer, examine such person and ascertain his fitness for work either as a child or as an adolescent. A certificate of fitness is valid for 12 months for the date of issue but may be renewed. Any fee payable for a certificate under this section shall be paid by the employer and shall not be recoverable from the young person, his parents or guardian. Sickness and maternity benefits. Every worker shall be entitled to obtain from his employer in the case of sickness certified by a qualified medical practitioner sickness allowance. If a woman in the case of confinement or expected confinement, maturity allowance at such rate for such period and at such intervals as may be prescribed. provisions regarding penalties and procedures that states that for penalties for certain offences such as obstruction to an inspector, willful refusal to produce any register or other document, use of false certificate of fitness, detection by the employers of the provisions of the act or rules made thereunder, enhanced penalty after previous conviction. The above offences are all punishable with imprisonment or fine or both. Exemption of employer from liability in certain cases. Where an employer charged with an offence under this Act alleges that another person is the actual offender, he shall be entitled upon a complaint made by him in this behalf to have on giving to the prosecutor in this behalf 3 clear days notice in writing of his intention so to do, that other person brought before the court on the day appointed for the hearing of the case, and if after the commission of the offence has been proved, the employer proves to be the satisfaction of the court that he has used due diligence and enforced the satisfaction, that the other person committed the offence in question without his knowledge, consent or connivance. The said other person shall be convicted of the offence and shall be liable to be like punishment as if he were the employer, and the employer shall be acquitted. Obligations of the employers. Under this Act, employers are required to make effective arrangements for the supply of wholesome drinking water to workers, provide a sufficient number of latrines and urinals of the prescribed standards separately for men and women, provide and maintain such medical facilities for the workers as the government of other states are doing. If any employer fails to provide such facilities, the chief inspector of a plantation is authorized to provide the maintain such facilities and to recover the cost from the defaulting employer. Provide the workers with umbrellas, blankets, hats, raincoats, full boots or other amenities for protection against rain or cold. Having a welfare officer where the persons employing exceed 300 or more. Beedi and Cigar Workers Conditions of Employment Act 1966. Major legal provisions of the Beedi and Cigar Workers Conditions of Employment Act 1966 will be discussed here. Object of the Act: an act to provide for the welfare of the workers in Beedi and Cigar establishments and to regulate the conditions of their work and for matters connected herewith. Some of the important definitions relating to the Beedi and Cigar Workers Act. In this Act, unless the context otherwise requires, adult means a person who has completed 18 years of age. Child means a person who has not completed 14 years of age. Contractor means a person who, in relation to a manufacturing process, undertake to produce a given result by executing the work through contract labor, or who engages labor for any manufacturing process in a private dwelling house and includes a subcontractor, agent, munshi, thekedar or satledar. Contract labor means any person engaged or employed in any premises by or through a contractor with or without the knowledge of the employer in any manufacturing process. The rules regarding licenses. Any person who intends to use or allows to use any place or premises as industrial premises shall make an application in writing to the competent authority in such form and manner on payment of such fees as may be prescribed for a license to use or allow to be used such premises as an industrial premises. The application shall specify the maximum number of employees proposed to be employed at any time of the day in the place or premises and shall be accompanied by a plan of the place or premises prepared in such manner as may be prescribed. The competent authority shall, in deciding whether to grant or refuse a license, have regard to the following matters: the suitability of the place or premises which is proposed to be used for the manufacture of the Beedi or Cigar or both, the previous experience of the applicant, the financial resources of the applicant, including its financial capacity to meet the demands arising out of the provisions of the law for the time being in force relating to welfare of labor, whether the application is made bona fide on behalf of the applicant himself or in benami of any other person, welfare of the labor in the locality, the interest of the public generally, and such other matters as may be prescribed. A license granted under this section shall not be valid beyond the financial year in which it is granted, but may be renewed from financial year to financial year. An application for the renewal of a license granted under this Act shall be made at least 30 days before the expiry of the period thereof, on payment of such fees as may be prescribed, and where such an application has been made, the license shall be deemed to continue, notwithstanding the expiry of the period thereof, until the renewal of the license or of, as the case may be, the rejection of the application for the renewal thereof. The competent authority shall, in deciding whether to renew a license or to refuse a license thereof, have regard to the matter specified in subsection 3. The competent authority shall not grant or renew a license unless it is satisfied that the provisions of this Act and the rules made thereunder have been substantially complied with. The competent authority may, after giving the holder of a license an opportunity of being heard, cancel or suspend any license granted or renewed under this Act if it appears to it that such license has been obtained by misrepresentation or fraud, or that the license has contravened or failed to comply with any of the provisions of this Act or the rules made thereunder or any of the terms or conditions of the license. The state government may issue in writing to a competent authority such directions of a general character as that government may consider necessary in respect of any matter relating to or grant or renewal of licenses under this section. Subject to the foregoing provisions of this section, the competent authority may grant or renew licenses under this Act on such terms and conditions as it may determine, and where the competent authority refuses to grant or renew any license, it shall do so by an order communicated to the applicant, giving the reasons in writing for such a refusal. Rules regarding appeals. The state government may issue in writing to a competent authority such directions of a general character as that government may consider necessary in respect of any matter relating to the grant or renewal of licenses under this section. Subject to the foregoing provisions of this section, the competent authority may grant or renew licenses under this Act on such terms and conditions as it may determine, and where the competent authority refuses to grant or renew any license, it shall do so by an order communicated to the applicant, giving the reason in writing for such refusal. Inspectors. The state government may, by notification in the official gadget, appoint such of its officers or such officers of any local authority as it thinks fit to be inspectors for the purpose of this Act, and assign to them such local limits as it may think fit. The state government may, by notification in the official gadget, appoint any person to be the chief inspector who shall exercise the powers of an inspector throughout the state. Every chief inspector and inspector shall be deemed to be a public servant within the meaning of Section 21 of the Indian Penal Code. Provisions regarding health and welfare. There are certain provisions regarding health and welfare as stipulated in the Beedi and Cigar Workers Act. The names are cleanliness, ventilation, overcrowding, drinking water, latrines and urinals, washing facilities, crèches, first aid, canteens. Provisions regarding hours of work and employment. Working hour, wages for overtime work, interval for rest, spread over, weekly holidays, notice of period of work, hours of work to correspond with notice under Section 22, prohibition of employment of children, prohibition of employment of women or young children during certain hours. Onus as to age. When any act or omission would, if a person were under a certain age, be an offence punishable under this Act, and such person is, in the opinion of the court, prima facie under such age, the burden shall be on the accused to prove that such person is not under such age. A declaration in writing by a medical officer not below the rank of a civil assistant surgeon relating to an employee that he has personally examined him and believes him to be under the age stated in such declaration shall, for the purposes of this Act and the rules made thereunder, be admissible as evidence of the age of that employee. Notice of dismissal. No employer shall dispense with the services of an employee who has been employed for a period of 6 months or more, except for a reasonable cause, and without giving such employee at least 1 month's notice or wages in lieu of such notice. The employee discharged, dismissed or retrenched may appeal to such authority and within such time as may be prescribed, either on the ground that there was no reasonable cause for dispensing with his services or on misconduct as held by the employer, or on the ground that such punishment of discharge or dismissal was severe. The appellate authority may, after giving notice in the prescribed manner to the employer and the employee, dismiss the appeal or direct the reinstatement of the employee with or without wages for the period during which he was kept out of employment, or direct payment of compensation without reinstatement, or grant such other relief as it deems fit in the circumstances of the case. The decision of the appellate authority shall be final and binding on both the parties and be given effect to within such time as may be specified in the order of the appellate. General penalty for offence. Save as otherwise expressly provided in this Act, any person who contravenes any of the provisions of this Act or of any rule made thereunder, or fails to pay wages or a compensation in accordance with any other order of the appellate authority passed under Clause B of Section 2 of Section 31, shall be punishable for the first instance with fine which may extend to second or any subsequent offence with imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 1 month or more than 6 months, or with fine which shall not be less than 100 rupees or more than 500 rupees, or with both. Indemnity. No suit, prosecution or other legal proceedings shall lie against any person for anything which is in good faith done or intended to be done under this Act or any rule or order made thereunder. No suit or other legal proceedings shall lie against the government for any damage caused or likely to be caused by anything which is in good faith done or intended to be done in pursuance of this Act or any rule or order made thereunder. Friends, I hope you have understood the contents well. You can also refer to other quadrants of this module for testing your knowledge and having some more input on theme of the module. Happy learning!